Join us with a COVID-19 update and to discuss Sweden's response to the pandemic and with what Americans can learn from it is author and former New York Times columnist Alex Berenson. Alex, welcome back to KUSI.
Thanks for having me, Paul.
All right, Alex, we have a couple graphs I think I swiped from your Twitter feed. By the way, since you've last joined us, you've gained another 25,000 Twitter followers, so you're I watch it grow exponentially as I watch positive test results grow. But we're looking at, you can't see it, but we're looking at a number of people that have succumbed to the virus in Sweden, and it shows a very sharp downward trend. But then I hear people on the other side of the argument say, no, Sweden is an example of how not to do it. Could you be the arbiter here and tell us which way we should view Sweden?
Well, I mean, look, here's the thing about Sweden. Sweden didn't lock down. They really, of all the countries in Europe, certainly in Western Europe, they had the least aggressive response. So in some ways, what you're seeing with Sweden is what you would call the natural history of the virus. This is what happens when you sort of let it take its course. And what's interesting is it doesn't look very different what Sweden had than what, let's say, a state like New York had or a country like France had. You have this spike at the beginning, the virus, there's a lot of spread, and then there's some deaths, for sure, there's some deaths. And then slowly the deaths decrease, the hospitals are slowly empty out, and it doesn't seem to matter, actually, if there's a lot of cases later on, if there's a lot of positive tests later on, because Sweden has had that now. Which is very interesting. And what that suggests is it's another way of saying this is a virus that that attacks some vulnerable people very hard, people in nursing homes, people really, you know, older people with a lot of comorbidities who have heart disease or have end-stage renal, you know, or kidneys are failing. All people like that are at real risk from this. Most of the rest of us are at very low risk from this. And the reason Sweden's had a lot of deaths, actually, is they didn't do a good job protecting their nursing homes. And there's some evidence that Sweden, actually, they were a little bit cold to people who were 85, let's say, and got this, and didn't really aggressively treat them. There's actually been stories written about that, too. So we don't have to make those mistakes, and we're not making those mistakes as much as we were a couple months ago in the United States. We're trying to protect nursing homes. We've gotten better at caring for people. But to me, the lesson of Sweden is that lockdowns don't really seem to do very much. And so lockdowns are incredibly societally destructive. And the idea that schools are not going to be in session next year is crazy. They're going to be in session all over Europe, and mostly without any crazy restrictions. So the lesson of Sweden is not, hey, nobody dies from this, and not, we need to do nothing about it. It's this idea of the lockdown as the cure doesn't really seem to be supported by the data.
Well, you bring up Sweden and New York State. Do we have that other graphic, gang? You watch, we have a graph showing the line of New York State compared to Sweden. And yet, suddenly, New York State's response is being heralded as the, hey, look, we wiped out the virus. And I'm looking at two lines that say, hey, Sweden did it a lot better.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, in New York, New York State has 18 million people and has had more than 30,000 deaths. It's really the worst hit geographic region in the world, along with, like Madrid, Spain, and northern Italy. So the idea that New York did anything right is crazy. And the reason that New York probably is, has no cases right now is it's likely that we know that a number of people, as many as a quarter of people based on the statewide studies, have antibodies to this, and that probably understates, certainly in New York City, 25%, and that probably understates the number of people who've been infected and recovered, because there's a lot of scientific evidence now that a lot of people who get this don't actually develop antibodies. They beat it with what's called their T cells, which is another part of the immune system. And so New York probably, we don't like to say herd immunity, but New York may be close to herd immunity. And that's meaning that everybody who's gotten this basically, or almost everybody who could have gotten this, has already gotten it and recovered from it or died from it. So that's New York. I mean, here's the thing. Right now, the country is being, it seems to be panicking again into a second, second quasi-lockdown. And there's so much less evidence to support that than there was a couple of months ago.
You bring up herd immunity. We're seeing that in the Latino community here in the South Bay and Southern San Diego, the same deal where the ethnic groups that took the brunt of the of the virus early on now are showing the best recovery and the lowest testing rate. Could herd immunity actually be a real thing? Because
it's definitely a real thing. It's just a question of how you get there and how much pain it is to get there. There's an Orthodox Jewish community in New York City that's clearly achieved herd immunity. You know, 70% of the people in that community have antibodies, which is or at least 60%, which is really an incredible number. You know, the question is how hard hit were they on the way there? So, this is not easy, but what's fascinating to me is I've been reading a lot about sort of the history of what people have recommended for flu pandemics, you know, because most of the recommendations were made with the idea of, oh, there's going to be a swine flu or you know, a Spanish type flu that could be really, really dangerous, much more dangerous than the coronavirus. And believe it or not, even when you talk about something that might kill millions of Americans, which the coronavirus clearly is not going to do, the recommendations are generally pretty limited. They're not let's lock down the world. They're wash your hands, sneeze into your jacket, you know, maybe put a mask on, maybe. And we're not going to close the schools forever. And we've just forgotten that. We've just panicked in a way that would have been unthinkable 6 months ago.
Alex, I read your Twitter feed and I see the blowback you get. I get it to a certain extent whenever we do these interviews just by asking questions, because everyone says, well, what if you're wrong? What if one child gets sick? What if one teacher succumbs to the virus? What if one grandparent gets the disease from a kid that goes to school? How do you respond to those people who are legitimately scared of a very serious infection?
That's not a realistic goal. People get sick and die from the flu. Children die from the flu. Teachers die from the flu. And children die in drownings. We don't say, you know, you can't have a pool. Children die in car accidents. And we don't say you can't drive. The risks of this, of coronavirus, to people under 30 and really people under 50 who are in decent shape, by which I mean not really sick, are just very low, and people need to recognize that. They need to recognize that the media has really made this look much more dangerous than it is, certainly for children. And it is not fair to have a standard of nobody can ever die from this. We if that were the standard for the flu, we wouldn't have schools.
Right. All right, Alex, thank you for making time for KUSI once again. And next time we talk, you'll probably be over 250,000 Twitter followers.
All right, Paul. Talk to you again soon.
Alex Berenson, former New York Times columnist, who has a pamphlet out on Amazon that is a bestseller as it relates to unreported truths of COVID-19. You should